while your day is winding down. Just getting started. This is South Coast Tonight with Chris McCarthy and Marcus Farrow. They've got you covered on all the news of the day, from local issues to politics on both sides of the aisle. This is the place where the movers and shakers come to be heard, to listen, and where they're held accountable. This is South Coast Tonight on WBSM.
Hey, welcome to South Coast Tonight. I'm Marcus Farrow. It was actually Phil Collins' 72nd birthday yesterday. Chris, Rep. Chris Markey had sent Chris McCarthy and me a text letting us know that, and I appreciate that. So happy birthday to Phil Collins. Chris McCarthy will be back tomorrow, but I'm joined now by a special guest co-host, Jared Valanzola. Jared, how are you?
I'm well, Marcus. How are you? Thanks for having me.
So, Jared, for people who listen to Jess's show on Saturday from 1 to 4, and if you don't, I think you should. For people who listen to Jess's show, they've probably heard you. You've guest hosted with her a couple of times, and you've just been a guest on her show before. But for people who are just being introduced to you now, can you introduce yourself to the audience?
Yeah, absolutely. In 2020, I was elected Plymouth County Commissioner, so I serve the South Coast through Mattapoisett.
He's Marion. A Republican.
I am a Republican. Marion, Mattapoisett, Rochester, the South Coast part of the of Plymouth County, all the way up to Hingham and Hull. But before that, I've spent many years in Republican Party circles. I worked in the State House for former Senator Bob Hedlund, now the mayor of Weymouth. Also worked for Representative Dave DeCoste for a brief time up there as well. I am the national committee man for the Massachusetts Federation of Young Republicans.
Okay.
And for the last 5 years, I have had the pleasure of hosting my own program on another station that is out of range from WBSM.
Yes.
So that I can give that plug without giving the call signs. But I've been in around and involved for about 20 years. I joke my first volunteer campaign was Mitt Romney for governor in 2002, which for some folks on the Republican side, that might get me harangued and ran out of the party these days.
It wasn't that long ago where Mitt Romney was the savior of the Republic.
Right.
For Republicans, right?
Exactly.
In 2012.
Yeah. Exactly. It's amazing how that changes. So I've had a lot of fun. I enjoy coming around and appreciate being down here tonight with you, Marcus, and looking forward to the next 3 hours.
Should be fun. So Jared, you heard our friend Jess on with Howie in the last hour. A couple called in a couple times to give updates on this MassGOP thing. I want to start by saying, and I've said this multiple times, that I think Jess and Howie have gotten in front of this before the rest of the state did, really, right?
Absolutely.
And, you know, a lot of it because of their passion for the issue and a lot of it because of their, you know, on the ground Republican contacts. So you, you know, you're obviously very involved in the state Republican Party. You're a Republican elected official, one of the few. Although Plymouth County's pretty good, right?
We have a little wall around us.
Yeah.
We get protected a little bit. We didn't have any losses. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, right. Because Sheriff McDonald ran unopposed.
Correct.
And Tim Cruz. Yeah. We had the debate here. Yeah.
Yep.
And he got reelected pretty soundly, I think, against a strong opponent.
He was, who spent $150,000 on his campaign.
At least.
We also reelected my Republican colleague, Commissioner Wright. So another little tidbit for folks listening. The Plymouth Board of Plymouth County Commissioners is the only Republican majority partisan elected board or commission in Massachusetts.
Wow.
Yeah. So we're lucky to have a little slice of Republican heaven in Plymouth County.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things I always mention about it, and I know we might talk a little bit more about what we do there later, but one of the things that I think is important, and it's interesting, it'll be a tie-in. And actually, before I forget, I wanted to mention I'm a huge Beatles fan too. I met Paul McCartney. Phil Collins hates Paul McCartney, so that was an ironic entry. He hates him. But one of the things that I think is important that we do in Plymouth County, and I think it's a testament to Sheriff McDonald, D.A. Cruz, Commissioner Wright, the Republican reps in the county, Sullivan, DeCoste, D'Amelia, Susan Gifford down here in Wareham, Matt Muratori, and Senator Patrick O'Connor, is I think we demonstrate what decent conservative...
Oral, too, right?
Normal, that's right, in Lakeville. Yeah. See, I always go by the Plymouth and the district name.
Lakeville's Plymouth County.
Lakeville is Plymouth County. I think that's it. I didn't miss it. We used to have Rep. Zaros. They took that precinct out of his district, though, in Plymouth. But one of the things I think that we hopefully demonstrate is what just decent common sense Republican leadership can look like. And I think, hopefully, and I believe we do because we were all soundly reelected last year, that I think we demonstrate that, what decent, honest Republican leadership can look like. And the voters in Plymouth County, thankfully, have returned a lot of folks to positions that otherwise have been lost across the state.
So there's this infighting going on in the MassGOP that you've been following. You have a relative that's been very involved in it.
Indeed.
So for people who don't know about that story, your cousin, Lindsay Valanzola, she's up in Central Mass.
Lives in Wales. And when people ask, where's Wales?
I just found out that town existed right now.
And when people say, where is Wales? I say, it's next to Holland. Central Mass.
Yes. And she was kicked off the state committee briefly by the chair, Jim Lyons.
Day after the election, November 8th was the election. Mm-hmm. November 9th, he sent a letter to her declaring her seat vacant because he deemed her to not be a resident of Wales any longer, no longer in the district. She's been working back and forth between Newton and Nashville, Tennessee. So she spends a lot of time in Nashville. But that said, Chairman Lyons, unfortunately, arbitrarily decided her seat was vacant. He went a few routes. He went to the Board of Registrars in the town of Wales, mm-hmm. who would not say she's not a registered voter. Her car is registered in Wales. Driver's license is in Wales. She votes in Wales. Mm-hmm. She pays taxes. So I'm not sure where they thought they might be able to get her eliminated based on all of that. I mean, she's posted on social media that she's been in Nashville. I've posted on social media that I was in Tampa Bay last month. I mean, people go away. So
if you're paying taxes in the town, you're a resident.
Right. And
your house is there.
Right.
You're a resident. Yeah.
Right. And I mean, in residency, I mean, you could kind of drive a cruise ship through what residency in Massachusetts is. Bottom line is she votes there. She lives there. There's really no other threshold for it. And
I lived in Bridgewater for a year. I was never a resident of Bridgewater, right? Because I went to college there.
I know a lot of people that do that, right? Yeah. I mean, I know a lot of we both know a lot of people that live in one place. They don't change it, right? Whether it be for college, maybe it's an apartment, and frankly, not to even be facetious, but a lot of times they do it for their car insurance, right?
Yes.
It's cheaper to insure your car in the suburbs than in the city of Boston.
Of course.
So they don't do that. So I think it's unfortunate. I think it encapsulated for me, aside from having the relation, you know, family relationship with Lindsay, it more encapsulated just taking that part of it out. Like, why are we spending time on this? You know, one of the things that disappointed me, and I'm not usually overly critical of the MassGOP because I exist to do my own thing as a county commissioner and some of the other positions I have on the local level in the party. But he spent $800 on a private eye to investigate where she was living. 2 years ago, I got a bill from the state Republican Party for $300 for a phone bank system that I lightly used. So I remember I quipped with the party at that time. Well, what's the point of running in the party if we're not getting data and resources at our event? If I got to pay for it, I'm just in a source.
Just do it yourself.
Just do it myself.
Yeah.
And it's disappointing for me to see I paid $300 for services that had otherwise been provided to candidates before, mm-hmm. but the party is more than enough money to spend $800 to investigate where a state committee member may or may not live.
Yeah. My own thing with the PI stuff, it's kind of like I can kind of sympathize with, and not totally, but you know, if you're in a position of political power and there are people that are coming after you, mm-hmm. wanting to find out about them, right?
Oh yeah.
But and I can also sympathize with investigating members of opposing parties that you want to beat. That's, you know, a lot of that's oppo research.
Right.
I think getting into the sex life of Maura Healey was a little bit dirty.
If they'd
found something salacious, you know, they probably, you know, I guess they would have been fair game to run on, but I think it was still a little dirty. It was never going to work because people, I don't think really care what Maura Healey's doing or not doing.
Going to make up the million vote delta? I mean, I don't know. I doubt it.
Yeah. A million votes. That's so many votes.
Right. I mean,
one million.
Rep Deal got a million less votes than Charlie Baker in 2018. You know, I don't know what looking into Maura Healey's sex life was going to do for that cause. And you look at, you know, we were talking off air about Rep Lenny Mara up on the North Shore, lost by one vote. Mm-hmm. I don't think the special House committee's ruled on him yet, but there was another seat in Middlesex County, Republican nominee lost by seven votes, gone. And you know, Marcus, as a Democrat,
they were encouraging a write-in Jim Lyons.
They were. Well, I don't know if Jim had his hands on that. It was Rick Green, who was his finance chair's parents, that encouraged that write-in. And that Republican writing
same circle.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, plausible, you know, birds of a feather.
Yeah.
The parents of Rick Green, who's a big finance person, encouraged that write-in. And I think one of the weird things that's permeated the Republican Party, especially in Massachusetts, but I see it nationally too as a national committee man on the YRs, is like, well, we're better off losing. We're better off getting in the fight and making whatever it is our principles are. And if we lose, whatever, at least we made our point. So many people now seem so hell-bent on just making a point.
Yeah.
And a lot of people will say to me, well, you don't make any points. We don't see you commenting on social media or anything. I don't make a point. I have two meetings a month.
Yeah.
That's where I make my point.
Yeah.
You know, and that's where we lead.
That's where you've been entrusted to govern.
To govern.
Yeah.
I can make all sorts of statements. It doesn't change anything.
Right.
And I think that's the problem that's been permeating the party for so long in this state, especially because we've been in such a micro minority.
I was just thinking about Phil Collins for a second, actually, because you said he hates Paul McCartney. And I'm just imagining sort of being famous enough and being in a position where you can hate Paul McCartney. Yeah, isn't right. that kind of wild?
It is, isn't it? Well, the story goes. See, I could talk music and mm-hmm. sports, too. The story goes, McCartney and Collins met at, and I forget where it was, but Collins thought McCartney was disrespectful when he said, oh, look, hey, it's little Philly here to introduce, like, little Philly wants to meet me or get my autograph, and yeah. Collins did not appreciate him calling Philly. But I did watch, and there's a great version, I don't know what it's from, but it's McCartney doing the Abbey Road medley, Golden Summer's Carry the Way at the end, with Phil Collins on drums. So maybe it was at that event that Phil Collins got insulted by McCartney, but McCartney, of all of them, nobody hates Paul McCartney,
yeah, right?
Like,
right.
Across the spectrum, everybody loves in music, celebrities, because he is a very, and I've met him, he's a humble, down-to-earth guy. So it is bizarre to think that yeah. like somebody out there hates him.
Yeah, I know.
Phil Collins hates him, which is funny.
That is funny. That's interesting.
Yeah.
So, Jared, and by the way, guys, 508-996-0500, Jared and I are going to be here all night. We want to talk about this because it's going on now. I know Jess is live tweeting it. We're going to track that. I know, Jared, you've got your...
I've got my little birds there.
You've got people inside that meeting, so we'll be able to get
like
live...
Like Varys and Game of Thrones.
We'll be able to get... Never saw it.
Oh, well, you know what? It. I would say you're missing it. The last two seasons were awful.
Well, so here's the thing. Here's my Game of Thrones rant. Okay. So I watched the first season. I didn't care for it very much. A lot of people said it gets a lot better. I never got around to watching the second season, third season, etc. But during that time, people were on social media just posting incessantly about it, and it got annoying. Like, oh my God, his name is Holdor, and he holds the door. Like, you know, just stuff like that. And I'm like, all
right,
guys.
Right, right.
So it got annoying, and so I just sort of stayed out of it. And then people were telling me that it's just because I'm a contrarian, and I like to bother people, and I like to, you know, throw stones and all that. And some of that's true, but you know, I couldn't get into it then. And then when I heard the last two seasons were terrible and it ended terribly, I'm like, well, now I'm never going to watch it.
Once they lost George R. R. Martin's source material, because he hasn't finished the book. So I have not read yeah. the book because he hasn't finished the series.
Yeah.
Once they lost the source material, though, yeah. it went way downhill. I would say I think you would like it because there is a lot of political intrigue. And I think for yeah, me, yeah. that's what really hooked me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also a huge fan of Emilia Clarke. She's my future wife someday. She doesn't know that yet, but I'm a huge fan of hers, her acting.
She's a great actress, yeah.
And her character arc, particularly, and maybe why I hate the ending, or really just...
I hear it was just straight up character assassination.
Her character. I mean, yeah. the growth that they... You know, you took such great writing, and you took her character in particular and yeah. transformed... And now, granted, I would have maybe accepted her character arc at the end if it didn't happen over the course of, like, 2.5 episodes. Like, if you yeah, gave right. me a season or two of it, fine, but not 2.5 episodes where... She's been the breaker of chains, the freer, like the entire character arc has been progressing to this more benevolent queen. And then
all of a sudden she goes nuts.
She goes nuts. Right. Yeah. It's like, I would have accepted because Targaryen, I'm getting super nerdy now, but like that's what happens in their bloodline. So like you'd accept that being sort of her fate, but not after two episodes. Like,
yeah,
if you gave me a year of it, maybe. But no, I think you'd like it. But, you know, that's. That's why it's just ending poorly.
So back to Jim Lyons.
Paul McCartney, Phil Collins, Game of Thrones, back to Jim Lyons.
So back to Jim Lyons. He hasn't been effective, obviously. You guys in Plymouth County were able to secure those key victories there. You didn't lose any seats It is the most competitive congressional district. You know, I remember Politico had a reporting on that, that, you know, Keating's district is the would be the one that Republicans could win. You know, I like Jesse Brown as a person. He came in here. He was nice. Wasn't the strongest candidate against Congressman Keating. I think if there were a stronger candidate, maybe. I still think it's a pretty tough sell. But a lot of that has to start with, even if, like, let's say Keating retires, the seat's open. It's a huge opportunity for Republicans.
Right.
Right? And Maura Healey's probably there for 8 years, realistically speaking, unless she runs for Senate, runs for president or something like that. She's real, and then still you have Kim Driscoll.
Right.
There, so that administration, this Democrat's probably going to be there for 8 years. So there's an opportunity, I think, to build a farm team, you know, that's, and that's where you got to start. You got to start at that level.
Right.
And so what are you looking for going forward that you didn't see in this cycle?
Yeah, I mean, in all honesty, you know, I mean, first to Bill Keating, you know, he's never lost. I mean,
no.
And credit to him, he's never lost. And
he's a force. Yeah.
And I don't think he ever will. And
I don't think so either.
And he's earned that. You know, I mean, politics is, you know, people think that politics and public service is something of, it's still marketing at the end of the day. When you've been elected to something for 50 years, you're going to have that name ID. What I would really like to see, in a shout out to my friends in Taunton, because I think Taunton is a good start for what we can do statewide on top of building off of what we've been doing in Plymouth County, is we have so long neglected local municipal races.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the races that matter. These are the races that are important. And I point out Taunton. Taunton has a 9-member city council. 6 of them are registered Republicans. Their mayor, of course, is Sean O'Connell, a Republican mayor. So a lot of opportunity there for them to run that city. And again, much like what we do at the county level in Plymouth, is demonstrate what decent conservative Republican leadership can look like,
mm-hmm.
and really create that brand. I think the biggest thing that the Republican Party in this state has an issue with is branding. And whether you're on Lyons' side or anti-Lyons is irrelevant. The bottom line is voters are looking at it and saying, I'm not trusting you with my vote. I don't care how good of a candidate Jared Valanzola is, although I won, but other candidates up and down the ballot, they're not going to trust their vote to you if the party is in such a disarray and offers such poor branding. And it doesn't have a point. Like, what exactly is the point? I mean, you mentioned it at the top. People don't care about Maura Healey's sex life.
No.
I don't care about anybody's sex life.
Right.
So I least of all the governors, you know, so I don't care about hers. And yet the state party made an investment in digging up dirt on it. And, you know, would it be a little more interesting if it was with subordinate employees? Perhaps. But none of that was ever found. It never came out. It was never found. So what I would really love to see, a concerted effort. And look, I've said this 100 times over the last 10 years I've been involved in GOP politics. If I were given carte blanche to run the Mass GOP, I would identify the top 10 state Senate seats and the top 20 state rep seats. And then for 10 years, I wouldn't run a single candidate for state rep or state Senate in those districts. I'd be running selectman candidates, school committee candidates, city or town council candidates.
Yep.
Because the beauty of that is, you know, you run 2 or 3 candidates, you get them elected, you see how they are as candidates.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they can hack it, maybe they can't. Sometimes people look good on paper. They don't translate on the field. Look at Ryan Leaf in 1998. Looked great on paper. Sucked as a quarterback. So sometimes people look good, and then they get there and they don't know how to perform. And that gives you a chance to further filter it out. And I think that Republicans would be wise to do that. And then you just start focusing on, then you have your candidate. You have your bench to be able to run state rep, state senate. I wouldn't run, if it were me, and I mean, it's the last thing I'd ever run for in my life in the state anyway, is Congress. I wouldn't run a single candidate for Congress, which might sound wild and revolutionary as a Republican. But to your point, Bill Keating, the ninth, you know, Rep Keating's district is the only one that we have even somewhat of a shot at.
Yeah.
And even that's a long shot.
Yeah, you know? Right.
So we're wasting our time spinning our wheels running against Ayanna Pressley in a Democrat plus 43 district. I mean, why would we do that?
Yes.
Jim McGovern, like, it's not happening.
It's a waste of time and resources.
It's not happening, exactly. So that would be my perfect world. I don't think that's going to happen regardless of the results tonight.
No.
It's certainly, unfortunately, you know, I think Chairman Lyons has talked about the grassroots. I'm not sure it's really been executed, but, you know, that's where we're at right now.
We're getting an update now. Taylor Cormier, executive producer of the Harry Carr Show, who's also a WBSM alumnus. He sent me the update from Jessica Machado. So there were the vote totals right now, just for people who are paying attention to this. Amy Carnevale, who is expected to, well, is the primary challenger. Our former sheriff here, Sheriff Hodgson, supported her. She's gotten a lot of support. She got 34 total votes. Jim Lyons got 33 total votes. And Liz Childs, who is the, the also-ran, got 5 votes. So she's going to get kicked off the ballot. And then Jim Lyons and Amy Carnevale are going to face off. But it looks like it's going to be fairly close on that one. So, if those are the total people that are voting, then those 5 votes are going to make the difference.
Those 5 votes will. And, it's interesting. There are people that have speculated on who these votes are. I know one of the women that nominated Liz Childs. Mm-hmm. So I can't say where. I guess the only thing I would have to think is, obviously, that is on its surface 39 votes against Jim Lyons.
Yes.
And that is 39 votes, not for Jim. And I will say, too, letting Lindsay vote broke that tie. Knew it was 33-33. Letting Lindsay vote brings you to 34. So it's going to be interesting to watch where those votes go. Or if they abstain. If they abstain, much like the Speaker of the House vote, it starts lowering the threshold. So
If they abstain,
my understanding is it will lower the threshold for election.
Yeah, because it's got to be the majority of the people that voted.
So, it'd be interesting. It's hard to beat incumbents, so it'll be interesting to see.
With the way everything's gone, you just think, you lose the sheriff's race down here, right, in a close election.
A 25-year sheriff, mind you, too. We talked about people sheriff. Not losing. Yeah.
Who's beaten serious opponents before? 25, and Paul Harrell ran a great campaign, but you lose a 25-year sheriff. You lose those two Cape County seats, the Cape and Islands DA, who that was a Republican seat for 50 years.
Since it was created
by what's his name, Murphy, Phil yep. Murphy, yep. And then what's his name? O'Keefe was Phil Murphy's first assistant yep. DA, and yep. he ran. So that's been basically the same Republican administration for 50 years. And then his deputy ran and lost pretty handedly.
Yeah.
The county sheriff's race was a little bit closer with Tim Whalen. It was a state rep. That was a little bit closer. But then Tim Whalen's seat went to a Democrat.
Yeah.
So you lose all of any Cape seat that was up for that was open was lost. Not to mention the 2 state rep losses there, a close Senate election in Needham, Norfolk County area with Becca Roush and Sean Dooley.
Yeah.
Yep. And now it looks like it's going to be fairly close. Is this, before we take a break, I got to ask this question. Is this a Trump thing? Is this a Trump versus never Trump? Or is it, my understanding is Amy Carnevale is okay with Trump. She has a picture, she's floated a picture of her with him. So this isn't really a Trump versus a never Trump thing, is it?
No, in all honesty, I think there are some that are making it that. But that said, Jim Lyons was a Ted Cruz delegate in 2016. Yeah. So for anybody that's holding out based on that, I don't think it is, at least on this state committee level vote, I think it's Jim has a lot of loyal supporters, mm-hmm. and I will give them credit. They are very loyal to him, and he's been very loyal to them back, too. So so Jim has been able to cultivate a lot of those, and in a lot of ways, again, there are a lot of people who appreciate the noise, and he makes a lot of noise. Yeah. And I always attribute a lot of what a lot of state committee members do, banging pots and pans. Like, mm-hmm. you're making noise. You're not doing anything. It's like me banging pots and pans and saying, well, I made dinner. No, I just clapped a bunch yeah. of pots and pans. I didn't get anything right. done. And yeah, that's not to say Jim hasn't gotten nothing done, but, you just go through the losses. That's just in the area, especially on the Cape. The only thing I might be able to give an excuse on the Cape results is a lot of folks with COVID moved there, working remote. So maybe the demographic on the Cape has changed in a way that we as Republicans weren't prepared for. But, we've been unprepared. Look, when I ran in 2020, I know we had to get to a break, but when I ran in 2020, I had a plan for early voting and vote by mail in my own race. And every Republican top to bottom was like, oh, what are you doing that for? We don't vote by mail. I'm like, well, there's like 15,000 Republicans in Plymouth County that voted earlier by mail in the primary. So I'm going to assume they're going to vote early by mail in the general.
Yeah. Well,
people don't change their habits usually. And I had a concerted effort to reach them, and I won my race by 10,000 votes. I think if I had ignored those voters, you know, I made the joke, once you're done voting for president, make your way down to the bottom of the ballot and vote for me.
Right.
Last in the ballot, first in your heart, you know, something quippy like that, but it worked. It mattered.
We're going to take a break. We'll be right back.
Download the W.
I thought Phil Collins would be a good play-in.
Love it.
Underrated song.
I like Phil Collins. I like Genesis.
No, he's obviously great.
One of the greatest drummers of all time. One of the few that can sing and write music.
Yeah. No, he's... I just really like the song. It's better than... The movie's fine, too. It's from Tarzan.
I would probably, Invisible Touch is probably my favorite song of his.
Oh, we'll play that next.
Nice. I don't know why it is, but it is.
So we're here with Jared Valanzola. Sorry.
That's
Jared
right.
Valanzola.
Better than what I usually call.
Our special guest host for the evening. If you want to message us on the app chat or you want to give us a call at 508-996-0500. I'm actually getting a message from the audience now asking about what do you think of Charlie Baker's performance, and is he the model of what you want to see going forward?
I would give the governor, Governor Baker, a decent grade. Ideologically, I'm more conservative than him, so mm-hmm. there are certain policy points I disagreed with him on. But I think that is the current statewide model. I mean, that's how he was elected. It's how Romney was elected. You know, mm-hmm. then Romney was a chameleon and became conservative nationally, and now I don't even know what he is as
a believes
senator.
Nothing.
But Paul Cellucci was fairly moderate. Bill Weld was fairly moderate. I think that is the statewide model. I think there are pockets where...
Scott Brown,
as well. So I think there are pockets where ideologically conservative Republicans can and have won,
mm-hmm.
but it's small pockets. It's not going to be a statewide translation. The bottom line is you need to attract unenrolled voters to vote for you, and they're unenrolled for a reason. I always liken people registered in the party generally, and I know this is a very broad generalization, but if you're registered in the party, you're invested in the party, but by and large, on either side, you tend to skew one more toward the right or more towards the left if you're in the party.
Mm-hmm.
When you're outside the party, there's a reason you are. And I think running a very right-wing candidate, unfortunately in Massachusetts, isn't going to translate to success statewide. And I know the exact retort. Well, Mari Healy's very left-wing. Well, it's a Democrat state.
Yeah.
I give the example of Texas all the time. Look at several years back when Texas ran Wendy Davis, right?
Oh,
the
God.
State senator.
Yeah.
Against, was it Rick Perry back
then?
It was Rick Perry.
I remember that.
Democrats in Texas believe we need to run a dyed-in-the-wool progressive liberal because we can't win these statewide races because we're running these squishy Democrats. Well, then you ran her and she lost to Rick Perry by over 20 points.
Yeah.
Or again, Beto or Stacey Abrams. So it happens in other states. Just on the Republican side, it happens to us here.
Well, with Wendy Davis, I remember her. She was a state senator. Her claim to fame was the filibuster.
Yes.
Yeah. And she had like a 20-hour, whatever, 12-hour, a very long filibuster.
Right.
And I remember she famously wore like Nike, like sneakers instead of like, you know, the high heels or whatever, uncomfortable dress shoes
right.
that people would wear if they're in the state house. And she had this long like filibuster. I think it was about abortion, but and then that was sort of her state. Then she kind of rode that to a statewide platform, but it didn't work out right. very well. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
I think to just tie up the question. The biggest thing to remember is Charlie Baker would have been, I think, a different governor, and he would have governed differently if he had a veto-proof minority in either the House or the Senate. And you can look no further than Bill Weld's first 2 years when he had a veto-proof minority in the state Senate. So he could veto legislation, and those vetoes would be upheld, and that allowed for more friction. Charlie Baker talked a lot about friction in state government, mm-hmm. and I've often said – I sum up Charlie Baker very broadly. He made awful things bad, right? You know, at least from my perspective as a Republican. So, but if he had a veto-proof minority in either chamber, it would have been a much different story on the way he governed, because he could have vetoed things, and Democrats would have had to have played more ball with him because they would not have had the votes to override it.
There was also a certain point where that veto-proof minority was a little bit closer when there were like 7 or 8 senators
at 7.
So they needed a couple, just a few more, right? Probably.
I think you had to get to 14. What's 2/3 of 40? Mental math. And there's nothing better on the radio than math.
Yeah, I know. So still close, a lot closer than now.
Yeah, you would need about 14 senators.
14 senators.
Halfway there.
Yeah, they were halfway there.
In the House, I think it's 54. Mm-hmm. And we were close to 40.
But all you need is one chamber.
Right.
The Senate. The Senate would be. The Senate would be probably where that is. Yeah. In terms of making, as you said, awful things bad. Based on your definition of what's awful and bad.
Right. Which might be different than yours, Marcus.
Yeah. But I think the grand bargain's a good place to look. Where basically there was going to be a ballot referendum that was going to make $15 minimum wage like the thing that was going to happen immediately. Like they were going to act on that.
Right.
And Charlie Baker had said, "Wait, hold on. Let's get everybody together. Let's sign a legislation that gradually increases it over time." Not a fan of that personally, but that would be a situation in which he did that. Also, the police reform bill that a lot of people don't like. In the Republican side, I know a lot of law enforcement officers don't like either. He was able to make some changes on that based on his, and I think he might have had some support from more moderate Democrats.
Oh, he did. Yeah, the police reform bill, especially, he did, and he knew he had the numbers that he could work with to get that done.
Yeah.
So to that end, I mean, look, and there's very specific things that I could say about the governor, especially as it relates to county government. That I'm more optimistic for Mara Healey, but from her with county government than Governor Baker. But
yeah,
but I think overall, whether you liked him ideologically or not, I know it's a hard reality of, Republicans in Massachusetts, they're having this conversation tonight, right now.
Mm-hmm.
But Republicans in Massachusetts really need to have a hard look and a hard conversation about what it is that we are going to be. And being honest with ourselves, I think so many of us, and I was guilty of it for many years too, are not honest with where we are, where we live, what that means to voters. Massachusetts, if they see offices and names they don't recognize, they're going to default to voting for Democrat. That's just the way it is. In Oklahoma, they default to voting Republican. That's just the way it goes.
Apparently, your cousin Lindsay's getting cheers at the meeting right now.
She votes.
Yes, apparently.
Well, because they are onto the second ballot.
Yep, they're onto the second ballot. So, we'll see how that goes. There's a couple of our state committee members there. A couple of our state committee's members there from Bristol County, from this Senate, because it's by Senate district. So, Jill Usach and Brock Adaro are there. We know Jill Usach, who was a Ward 3 candidate a few years ago, was a New Bedford School Committee member.
Yes, yes.
Still works for the sheriff's office. She voted for... she's not voting for Jim Lyons. She made that very clear. So she wants to see the party move in a different direction.
Yeah, I'd
and
be shocked.
In fact, when she ran for Ward 3 City Council about 6 years ago in that race that Hugh Dunn won, she got an endorsement from Charlie Baker. He'd written her an endorsement and gave her an official statement on that. So pretty interesting stuff. We'll see.
There was an investment. I mean, I will say this. I have friends in both, and I hate saying both sides of the party because it just seems inherently ridiculous in a party of 9% registration that we have two camps. But I have friends on both sides, and a lot of them have rolled up their sleeves and done the work. But I look at results. I just look at the results. And you mentioned it before. We had 7 Republican state senators not too long ago. We're down to 3 now.
Mm-hmm.
They can carpool together in a compact car,
Yeah, right.
At least before they needed a minivan. So... and even in the House side, I mean, we were close to 40.
Yeah.
I think now it's down to 26 to open this session. So it's hard to watch for me. Like I've poured a lot of time into so many local races in Plymouth County.
Yeah.
And so for me as a Republican, it's just disappointing across the board, all of it. And I think the truth, no matter what side you're on, the truth always lies in the middle of all of these conversations. But I think on its surface... saying you want to run for chair one more time so you can execute a $5 million lawsuit because you didn't like that people said things. And granted, there was one person who said terrible things about Jim that never should have been said. So I don't don't want to lump that in. But the rest of it, I don't personally see how that's a decent use of our time, our activism. And, you know, I think somebody made the comment, well, the MassGOP can do these lawsuits and still run the party and run candidates at the same time. But they can't. We didn't win anything last year.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
So, no, you can't, unfortunately, for whatever reason that is. I don't know, but you can't.
So I got another message. We'll take a break, and then we'll get to that. Actually, we've got to take this break. We'll be right back.
New Bedford's News Talk Station, 1420 WBSM.
Nonprofit
Marcus McCarthy. South Coast Tonight is the place to react to all of the day's news and where they make some news of their own.
In right place.
Back to the talk now on WBSM.
Hey, welcome back to the show. I'm Marcus Farrow. I'm here with special guest host Jared Valanzola for the evening. 508-996-0500. The song just actually came in.
One of my favorite, probably my favorite Phil Collins. Although this is Genesis, I know, but great song.
All right. So
I'm trying to think of how I could tie that into the MassGOP talk.
I'm not sure.
Yeah. Thinking lyrically, like how that could tie in, like Jim Lyons reaches in and grabs hold of your heart. Like, I don't know. Or Amy Carnival has
literally
just
grabs it, pulls it out. So Jared, we're obviously tracking the you know, you've got your sources inside. We have WBSM's Jess Machado, and who's been doing an excellent job on this story, really leading the conversation, I think.
She really has been.
Yeah, and so we're still tracking that. They're counting the ballots now, so we're going to know who the chair is for the MassGOP. I did get a message from somebody in the audience asking, who do you prefer for the 2024 presidential race, if anybody?
Oh boy, you know, I honestly haven't made my mind up. I've always liked Governor Haley, Nikki Haley, out of South Carolina.
She just declared.
Did she declare? Mm-hmm. She's officially in.
I'm pretty sure.
Certainly, Ron DeSantis as well is an option. I've always been a fan of Mike Pence. I think, luckily, on the Republican side,
Mike Pence got no shot.
No, I know. I think on the Republican side, we might have a small embarrassment of riches once we get by, you know, the elephant in the room. But, you know, my preference is anybody would be better than Joe Biden that's running.
Okay.
You know, I'm not dancing around this because I'm elected. I'm dancing around it for other reasons. But certainly
I get it.
Yeah. But I've always been a fan of Nikki Haley. I think she was a phenomenal governor in South Carolina.
I don't know if she's declared specifically, but I think it's one of those things. Which is more or less a declaration.
Now, what I do think is interesting is rumor has it Chris Sununu.
I was just going to ask you about Chris Sununu, governor of New Hampshire.
Chris Sununu. I don't know. I mean, I think the bottom line is there's a reason Donald Trump announced 2 weeks after the midterms, or a week after. I forget. I think it was a week after, right?
Yeah. To clear the field.
To try and clear the field.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you're looking at certain folks like Chris Sununu, he doesn't want to move up into the U.S. Senate for whatever reason. I think it was twofold. I think part of it was he didn't want to deal with the primary. He didn't want to deal with the Trump factor on the national level in 2022. Also didn't want to wait to get things done. So on the off chance he, you know, runs for president, I think, because he's been governor now 6 years.
Yeah.
Will it be? So, you know, now's the time to strike.
He was elected in 16.
He was. That's right. So you're looking at it would be 8 years, be concluding in 16. So and then with DeSantis in Florida, he's term limited. So for him, the time is now. I mean, DeSantis is going to run, and he will never be more relevant than he is right now.
Well, the thing was with DeSantis, too, it's a strike while the iron's hot thing, because if you wait too long, like Chris Christie waited too long,
exactly.
Right, then something comes up and your hopes are dashed, or people just more or less forget about you. So DeSantis is absolutely going to run. I think Chris Sununu is interesting to me because he has a pretty good presence, you know, he didn't seem interested in all the stuff in Washington. Like, and I think he genuinely likes being governor of New Hampshire. You've got an update.
We have breaking news.
Let's go.
Marcus,
Let's go.
I have this on authority from a state committee woman. Amy Carnival has been elected chairman of the Massachusetts Republican Party, winning 37-34. What is interesting about this is three votes that voted for Liz, voted for Amy, one vote voted for Jim, one vote abstaining. So We will have, we as Republicans, will have a new chairman of the Mass Republican Party. And that is coming directly from a state committee woman.
Do, wait, so how many votes did you say?
37, 34.
So Jim got one extra, Jim Lyons got one extra vote, basically.
Yes. Yep. And the rest. Amy got three.
Three. So Amy Carnevale is going to be the new chair.
She is. She will be the new chair. So that will settle that.
It's morning in America again.
Yes.
All right. We got to take this break. We'll be right back. Special guest host Jared Valanzola, Republican County Commissioner in Plymouth. So we just got that update. I saw Taylor Cormier from the Howie Carr Show texted me the same news that Jim Lyons is out. So there'll be new leadership in the state Republican Party. And, you know, hoping to, you know, I guess, recoup some of the losses and move towards an electoral strategy that's effective.
Yeah, you know, I mean, just to the outgoing chairman, I mean, it's sort of unceremonious how that goes, right? Now he's done. You know, I give Jim credit for putting up the conservative fight.
Do you?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, a little bit here. But it just... You know, especially the last 2 years, I think of his chairmanship. Unfortunately, the results speak for themselves. It just didn't work. And part of me wishes it would, but another part of me also thinks if I want good hardcore conservatism, I'll move to South Carolina. So
good point.
You know, I thank Jim for his service. It's not easy leaving the state committee. I've had friends and people that have been chairs of the state committee, and it's not an easy task or an easy job. And I wish him well and congratulate him on his tenure. And I congratulate Amy Carnevale on her victory. I think she's going to bring a certain temperament to the job that I think has been lacking. You know, I was very close with Kirsten Hughes when she was chair. And I think, you know, Amy will just bring a certain level-headed temperament to the job. And,